Welcome, viewers, to our show, Color of Justice. I'm your host, Milton Alimadi, and I'm also the publisher of the Black Star News. As you know, on our show, we look at cases of injustice in the so-called criminal justice system, where people go to court, people expect to get justice, and often that's not the case. And with us on our show today, we have a guest who's been with us before, Mr. Charlie Price. But for our viewers who missed our earlier show, maybe we should do a quick recap.
Okay.
You worked as a porter for about 30 years for the Bay Club.
Yes.
And you started with them around 1982.
Right.
And the Bay Club is a luxury condo with over 1,000 units in Bayside, Queens.
Yes.
And during your terms of employment, you were treated quite harshly, were you not?
Like a second citizen or something.
And you were referred to with a pretty nasty word consistently. And what was that word?
Dirty stinking nigger, we don't want you here, and so on.
And this was by your supervisor
and
managers,
employees, and some residents.
And co-workers. Mm-hmm. Now, out of a staff of 40, you were the only African-American employee. Is that not true?
Yes.
For the 30 years?
30 years.
Now, at some point, you made a formal complaint to the State Division of Human Rights.
Yes.
Is that true?
Yes.
And they conducted an investigation.
Yes.
And ultimately, they found a probable cause determination.
Yes, 2010.
Against your employer.
Right, 2010.
Okay, against the Bay Club. Mm-hmm. But against your union, 32BJ as well, right?
Yes.
So your union basically did nothing.
No.
To protect you from this.
No.
Harsh work environment, from these ugly language that we're using against you. And in fact, when the State Division of Human Rights did an investigation, they found witnesses who corroborated these ugly words used against you. Is that not true?
Yes, several witnesses, yes.
Okay, and at some stage, I understand, before the State Division of Human Rights could take this matter to court, the employer filed an Article 78.
Yes.
In State Supreme Court in Queens. Mm-hmm. And asked the judge to sign off and basically force you into an arbitration.
Yeah.
And what was the name of that judge, do you remember?
Yes, it's Robert Judge McDonald.
McDonald. Mm-hmm. And there was a problem with that arbitration because it stacked against you, is it not?
Yes, it was.
It was taken to the Real Estate Board?
Yes, and with the union, and they had witnesses who were not credible, and I had a lawyer who was incompetent, which I tried to fire several times.
But here's the other thing.
Mm-hmm.
The union, in a court of law, before a jury, would have been a defendant, right?
Yes.
But in this case, because of the arbitration setting, you were forced to submit to be represented by a union lawyer. Is that not correct?
Very correct, and it shouldn't have been like that. I should have been entitled to get my own lawyer, but they denied me.
So that was an obvious conflict of interest.
Obvious.
And you were not allowed to bring your own witnesses, you said, in this
so-called
arbitration.
Yes.
And at some point, you said you consider this to have actually been a kangaroo court.
Yes, and also a retaliation on the union part, because I had a probable cause against them also.
Right.
And they wasn't too happy about that.
Right. Now, and before you were actually fired, at some point, you also started exposing corruption that was going on at the Bay Club. Is that not true?
Yes.
Tell us about some of the things you discovered. I understand there were rigged contracts.
Yes. The ex-super who was fired had a nephew who worked there, and there was steering contracts.
Who was the super?
It was John Wamser at that time.
Okay.
And he had a nephew whom they was giving contracts for doing stuff around the building.
And what kind of stuff?
Construction, sheetrocking, remodeling people's apartment with their condos, kitchen, living room, put
but
down
But you're
floors.
Saying it was not based on competitive bidding. It was just...
No, it was all fixed.
And did he do a good job?
Excuse me?
Did he do a good job?
They had people complain. He tried to charge them twice. Yeah, there was a resident, several residents who said they paid him, and he tried to charge him again.
And what is the name of this company?
It was Touch of Class.
Touch of Class.
Right.
And then you said there were also cases where the bids were actually fake or doctored?
Well,
they changed the figures so that they could be awarded the contract? Did you say that?
Yes. They had outside bidders supposed to bid on a job, but they was only staged to make it legal.
And to make it appear legal.
Right, make it appear legal. And they gave the job to Bobby Caron.
And who is that?
And that's the ex-super nephew, okay. John Wamsa.
Okay, so it was basically what they called nepotism, when you steer it to the business to relatives.
A lot of kickbacks.
Kickbacks. I understand there was also payment to win contracts?
Yes. If you were a contractor coming in to fix the building, a leach, concrete, or whatever,
right.
Before you can get through that gate, you have to pay the super, depending on the job, anywhere from $1,000 to $2,000 or either $500.
Right.
And it's no guarantee they would get the job.
Interesting.
And that's been going on for years.
And at some point you said there was also embezzlement of funds from the accounts of the Bay Club?
Well, that concerning with John B. Lovett, concerning the...
John B. Lovett is the management
company. He's the management of the building.
And what happened?
And he was running the health club, and let's say money came up missing, and he was in the midst of it.
Of the Bay Club.
Of the Bay Club, yeah.
And you brought all this, what we are talking about right now, you shared this information with the district attorney's office in Queens.
Yes, I did, yes.
And you met with an assistant DA, is that not correct?
Yes, I did, that's right. It was the week or two after Hurricane Sandy, matter of fact.
And did the DA ultimately do anything about this?
Was no, there... she did not. She did not. And now, not only I, other witnesses went down and spoke to her also.
And provided the information.
Yes.
And evidence.
Yes.
And I understand there was documentation.
Documentation and everything.
Okay. Now, at some point after this, what you call the kangaroo court, the so-called arbitration.
Yes.
You were ultimately fired.
Yes.
And the employer also made sure that you were denied unemployment compensation.
Yes.
Have we done a pretty decent job in terms of summarizing what happened to you for our viewers who missed the show? Is there anything we left out that you'd want to?
Well, I know Judge McDonald had put my case into a stay position, and why he did that, I don't know, and nobody else doesn't know why he made that decision.
Okay, now for viewers who don't understand, you mean when you say stay, meaning it could not proceed to a trial in state Supreme Court.
Right. Human rights could
it was
even
stayed
touch it.
There. It had to go to arbitration.
It had
That's
to.
What you meant.
You're
okay.
forced to go to arbitration.
And then what happened?
Luckily, Mr. Joe Mazzilli went down to human rights, and he showed them a lot of evidence. And human rights got back on the case again.
All right, so for viewers who also missed our previous show, Joe Mazzilli is a retired detective.
Yeah, NYPD.
NYPD, who also is a unit owner at the Bay Club.
Mm-hmm.
And he also, I understand, provided information about the corruption that was going on.
And how
at
I
the
was
Bay
being
Club.
Treated.
And provided information to the DA as well.
Right. Yes, he did.
So you're saying he also actually came and spoke to people at State Division of Human Rights
yes.
concerning you.
Mm-hmm.
And what did he convince them?
Well, he convinced them that I was treated unfairly. He showed them how they was discriminating against me. And he showed them about the corruption that he uncovered that goes on at the Bay Club.
Mm-hmm.
And a lawyer in Buffalo, they got together for about a couple of months. And they presented some papers to the Judge McDonald to remove the stay case.
Mm-hmm.
And, of course, he denied me. But anyway, he the results of that got some type of positive action from him. So he pushed them to reopen the case and get it going, because it's been like over 2 years.
Okay, so there's still a stay. So is that what
you're saying? Sort of, yeah. But it's starting to move now. It's starting to move. As of next month, I have to go to, I think, a mediation on the 23rd.
Mm-hmm.
And they're talking about, see if we can sell this thing.
Who's talking about that?
The Bay Club and the mediator.
So it's not over then?
No, it's not over. Matter of fact, it's just getting started.
Well,
it's just getting started, because now we are moving forward, and I was informed that if it doesn't work out in some type of mediation and stuff, then it will go to arbitration with the union.
Wait, I don't understand that part.
Okay.
If the mediation does not...
If it doesn't, if we can't...
Between you and the Baycom.
Yes.
It would go back to the same arbitration that
yes.
you went through?
Yes.
How is that possible?
Because due to the bargaining contract, that's what they have to abide by.
All right, so
and then if it doesn't work out in arbitration, then right. human rights get back involved again.
Okay, so ultimately you want your day in court.
Yes, that's my main goal.
Okay, now that's against the Bay Club. I understand there's some activity going on with respect to the union as well.
Yes. The judge in the federal courts.
So you have an action against the union in,
yes. Yes.
in federal district court?
Federal district court. And let's just say she's not happy with what the union is doing and what they had did in the past. She's not happy at all.
Interesting.
And she told them that we are not, but they tried to dismiss the case on Article 78.
I mean, the union asked for the case to
yes.
be dismissed.
Yes, he had the papers and everything mm-hmm. and gave it to the judge. And she said, no, this is not going to be a quick dismissal. There's too much going on here. We are not going to dismiss this case.
So we may actually see either a trial or a settlement.
Yes. It's a strong possibility, yes.
All right. Now, tell us the importance for people that are watching this show and may have faced their own legal challenges as well. Tell us the importance of persistence. Because I think if you were not persistent, you would not be discussing...
Well, yes, I agree.
Positive development in your case.
Well, the president of the board had told the tenants, when they had like a tenant...
You mean the board of the
Bay
Club?
Yes. Mm-hmm. That they had beat me, they won the case and stuff like that. We beat him, he's gone. And I knew all along that the case was still in progress. But the main thing is, it's been 2 years now, and I've been fighting. I've been seeing lawyers. I've been seeing human rights. I've been seeing judge. You have to be persistent. If you're not, they're going to walk all over you. So they were trying to wear me down, but I can't let them just take away 30 years of my life and it just kicked me to the curb like this for something I didn't even do.
Right. Okay. Actually,
other people should have been arrested, like John Walmser. It was a forensic report. And the bottom line, after the investigation, which I participated in, okay.
All right, and for viewers that are not familiar, I think I know what you're talking about. You're talking about when you had exposed so much the corruption allegations mm-hmm. with the evidence.
Yeah.
Ultimately, at some point, the Bay Club hired a firm called Thatcher Associates.
Right.
And they conducted an investigation, and that's what you're referring to, right?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
But and what did they?
Well, they recommend that John Walmser and Gary Brenner should be fired.
And Walmser was
arrested.
The super.
Yes.
And the other one,
well,
Brenner, was the...
At that time, he was assistant super.
Okay.
Brenner.
And they said what? What did Thatcher say?
Oh, Thatcher's recommendation after the investigation was that they should be fired or arrested. And they turned around, let John Walmser resign with, I heard, $180,000, okay? To go away. Mm. Now, he's being paid for corruption, but being corrupt. Me, they took away my unemployment. They denied me everything, and they've been putting me through hell. But these people who should have been arrested, even after an investigation, they rewarded them with money, and they promoted the assistant super to be the super.
And is he still the super today?
No. After the arbitration, he came in alive. They fired him.
Oh,
and they gave him money, a package deal.
Okay, so they used him.
They used him
to testify against you at the arbitration.
Mm-hmm.
And then when
it was over,
they got you out of the way,
yeah.
then he was fired as well.
They thought I was out of the way.
Mm-hmm.
And then they fired him.
But you say he left.
And they fired his brother.
What was his brother doing there?
But now?
No, what was his brother doing?
Oh, he was working in the health club.
At the Bay Club?
Yeah, but he was known for being on drugs and other things.
Are you sure about that?
Oh, yes.
Is this something that you can prove?
Well,
can it be proven?
Yes, it can.
And what was the brother's name?
His name was Scott. I guess Scott Brenner.
And he's not longer working there?
No, they gave him disability.
Interesting.
Yeah, how you like that? So everybody's getting rewarded, but me.
Okay, now.
It's crazy.
Okay, now, I have another question for you. At the end of all this, how do you really feel?
There's so much going on inside of me. I'm not gonna lie, I feel a little angry. I have a right to be angry because of the injustice.
Of course.
Sometimes I'm depressed, okay? But through it all, I think it's starting to work out. Mm-hmm. If I had to gave up, they would have won. And those people are corrupt. I'm gonna say it again, they are corrupt, okay? In my opinion, I did nothing wrong. Mm-hmm. What, because of the pigment of my skin or whatever?
Right.
Okay, but through it all, I'm seeing progress. So I'm happy that I kept pushing.
Mm-hmm. Are you getting counseling?
Yes, I am getting counseling. Mm-hmm. I've been going about 5 or 6 months now. Mm-hmm. Once a week, 5 or 6 months, mm-hmm. counseling, medication, and.
And that helps at all?
It helps, yeah. I was shocked that I didn't know that I had put on so much weight until I went to the doctor. And now they're saying because of the stress and I had gained a lot of weight, I developed diabetes, high blood pressure, and other things. I got everything documented.
Yeah, you got to take care of that.
Yeah, I got to take care of that. But I'm starting to feel a little bit better.
You want to be around to see the case through.
Well, yes, you're right. Mm-hmm. You're right.
Now, didn't you have another challenge as well? I understand you were taking care of your elderly mother as well?
Yes. She has dementia and other things, so I'm spending a lot of time cooking for her and, you know, doing little things, shoveling snow. Mm-hmm. And I hate to say it, but it's just a lot more on me mm-hmm. at this time.
Right.
You know, I just need some good news.
Right.
I need some good news, you know.
Right. And if you were to do this all over again, would you, given the
yes, I would.
Cost?
Because I did nothing mm-hmm. wrong.
Right.
I did nothing wrong. I mean, why should I take people calling me dirty thinking nigger? I mean, even back in 2000, back in 83, just say it real fast.
First started working
there. Yeah, mm-hmm. I go up to the super to get a radio because I worked at that time from 4 to 12. So when I came in, the regular crew had left.
Mm-hmm. You know, on that day.
Yeah. So anyway, I go and get a radio. I politely ring the bell. The son come through the door. Mommy, the
nigger. Whose son?
John Wamser, the ex-super. Mm-hmm. The son come through the door. Mommy, the nigger's at the door.
That's what the son said?
Yeah. And I was shocked. I mean, I was shocked.
How old was the son? Where did
At the time, he was 9 years old, but that teaches me that this
where
is...
Did, where did he grow up? Here in New York?
From Florida. Came in from Florida, fresh out of Florida, accent and everything. So the mother comes to the door, she apologized. I stood by the door and listened, and they closed the door. I never forget. We can't call them that anymore. We're not in Florida. I never forget that.
That's what the mother told the
yeah,
son.
Yeah, we can't call them that no more. We're not in Florida. So that shows me this is what they are taught around
the
family.
Now let me ask you this. The son was how old at that time?
He was 9 years old. But the whole family was racist.
By the time they, you said Wamser's gone now, right?
Yeah.
When they moved out, how old was the son then?
Ooh, man.
How long was Wamser there after 83?
After 83? Well, he was there for the full time. I think now it's about 2.5 years.
Only?
Yeah.
But he's gone?
Yeah, he's gone.
So
and the son works there.
Up today?
Yeah, he still works there. He's the concierge.
But he never called you that word again, I take it.
Not
in front of you anyway.
No, he never called me that, but you can tell.
Did he ever?
With his family, they're racist. That's where they were brought
did
up.
Did the son ever explain, did he ever discuss that issue again?
No.
In later years?
No.
Interesting. Now I have another, I remember in one of our earlier meetings, you discussed something that I think it was either Wamser or the other super who said something interesting after Barack Obama was elected president.
Oh,
who was it?
Oh, yeah, that was Wamser, whose son called me, mom the niggas at the door. This guy is so racist, man. And when Obama got elected, the whole building was like in shock, okay? And
but you were obviously celebrating.
You see, I'm going to tell you the truth. Mm-hmm. When the people, being I was the only Afro-American worker there.
Right, you wanted to be careful.
Yeah, but they kept asking me how I felt.
Right.
And what I told them was, I'm happy about the world, the nation, mm-hmm. voting for this guy. I said, I'm more happy for America.
The country.
The country. Because they all got together and they voted, mm-hmm. regardless he's an Afro-American or not. I said, that's what made me feel happy.
It meant the country was evolving.
Right,
that's
right,
what you,
exactly.
That's what you meant.
Yeah, people was moving beyond that mm-hmm. racist stuff, color line.
Right.
I said, that's what made me really happy. Mm-hmm. But they couldn't understand it. That wasn't what they wanted to hear. But like, he was saying that he should be
Who?
Shot in the head. John Walmsley, he was the super. He was saying that somebody, they should shoot him in the head.
And that's a serious.
And I reported it to
you
Human
reported
Rights.
To
I reported it.
State Division of Human Rights.
Yes, I put it in my complaint.
That's serious. Do you know if they ever?
They never.
You don't know whether somebody's just. Even if you're just saying it's wrong. Do
yeah.
you know if it was ever reported to the police or the
President
Secret
of the United
Service?
States,
or,
just because he's Afro American, you want to pull a bullet through his head.
Do you know if this was reported to the proper authorities?
Not that I know. All I know is that when I made my report to Human Rights, I put that in there. So that was like years ago. Mm-hmm. I put it in there. And for that, matter of fact, the Eugene Gardner, who worked for Lovett Associate, they knew about it. But to them, it was just a joke. Mm-hmm. They just laughed. Mm-hmm. They just laughed.
All right. I just have a few more questions
yeah.
for you. You've been... essentially representing yourself.
Yes.
You've had a tough time trying to get a lawyer.
Yes, no lawyer, no nothing. If I had a lawyer, I would have made grounds faster, mm-hmm. okay? But most lawyers I spoke, every lawyer I spoke to, when I finally understood what he was talking about, most of them said that they don't know if they could remove the stay mm-hmm. that Judge McDonald made.
I see.
So that was the monkey wrench in my gears.
Okay.
But they took my money.
So they would listen to the case,
yeah.
and then once they realized there was a stay,
right.
meaning they couldn't
Judge McDonald,
proceeding. Okay.
Yeah, and so he had everything frozen. So that was when the president of the Bay Club, Barbara, she made the announcement to the tennis meeting. She had a chest out. We beat Charlie, we beat him. No more, we got him. Mm-hmm. So they thought I was gonna walk away.
Judge McDonald.
Yes.
Did you speak to other people or lawyers? Is this an unusual kind of action that he did? What did the Human Rights Division say? Because essentially what the judge was doing
was freezing her. He was working with the Bay
Club.
But
not only that, he was not only, what did you say?
He was working with the Bay Club. He knew mm-hmm. somebody in there. Because most people I spoke to, even some judges, I'm not going to call no name, they don't understand why he did that. Mm-hmm. And people I know who know Judge McDonald, his own peers, his own judges in his circle, who asked him, why did you do that?
Interesting.
Yeah, very interesting.
Because not only did he freeze you and human rights from
proceeding,
he also froze you from being able to get another attorney. A private attorney to represent you.
You're right. Because
very
they all said that I don't know if I can remove a judge decision with a stay. It's like they didn't have the power.
And this is State Supreme Court in Queens.
Yeah.
Okay, but so let's recap now. You have two actions going on right now.
Right.
You have the federal, federal district court against mm-hmm. the union.
Right.
And you have the mediation coming up.
Right. 23rd next month.
With the Bay Club.
Mm-hmm.
And is there anything else that that we left out?
Well, as far as I'm concerned, they did me wrong. The people who should have been punished, their reward. I mean, you have people around there, handyman by the name of Hector, the Tristan guy, trying to save money. There's a certain cape, I forgot the name of it, for putting inside the walls. It has like a metal frame around it mm-hmm. and electrical wires running through it.
Right.
He's trying to save money so he could get extension cord, a big roll of extension
and
cord.
And who is he?
He's an ex-handyman.
Oh, for the Bay Club.
Yeah, does a lot of side jobs. So anyway, he was installing electrical exhaust fan in the mm-hmm. kitchen. Anyway, the wrong wiring, a lot of apartments caught a fire, okay? And really? Even to
because of his wiring.
Yeah,
because
his wiring.
Well,
it was the wrong wiring.
How many units did he wire?
Oh, he did like hundreds of them.
Really?
Yeah.
Between what year?
You kidding me? Back in the 80s on up until he left. Because just his.
So like, what you're saying is that the wiring has not been corrected?
No.
Up to date?
No. Because they can't tell the resident that an employee put the wrong wires in your walls. Mm-hmm. But plenty of time, this apartment caught a fire. I mean, nothing major. They got on top of it, but smoke all in the hallways. And I knew the apartments, most of the apartment this guy was doing. He was bragging about
it. That's interesting. So you're saying in order to save money, the Bay Club.
No, he did. He did on his own time.
Okay. Oh, I see. So he was being paid.
Yeah, side job.
Extra.
Side job, but on company time. Okay? So instead of putting a special cable, when you do a house, there's like a electrical cable that has metal around it.
Were the Bay Club aware of this?
Yes. Yes, they knew that. John Wamsen knew about it and Eugene Gardner. But he already had installed so many of them in people's apartment, they couldn't let them know that they knew this because it's a big fine.
Do the current managers of the Bay Club know that there's still potential risk existing?
They know that. But as a matter of fact, they tried to get an employee to go into an apartment. They were going to blame him for it. And I tipped them off.
Okay, explain what you meant. I didn't understand.
Well, they knew the apartments that had the bad wiring.
Right.
So there's another employee, which they don't like.
Right.
They sent them up there to do some electrical work.
I see.
And they was going to blame him for
everything else that had already messed up.
And I went back and tipped him off, and he caught on to it, and he didn't go up there.
And that employee is still there?
No, they fired him too.
They fired him too. Okay, interesting. Not surprising.
No, they fired him too.
All right, yeah, you know what we're going to do now? We should probably take a break.
Okay.
We should wait for you to come back and finally give us some less depressing news when you visit with us next time.
I hope so. I want some good news too.
Of course. Tell us how the mediation goes.
Okay.
Tell us how your action in a federal district court goes.
Mm-hmm.
And we wish you the best.
Thank you.
We wish you the best in taking care of your mother as well.
Yes, thank you.
And we thank you for your persistence. And I think
thank you for having me.
Viewers that are listening know that the last thing you want to do is to give up on yourself.
I'm never going to give up. Mm-hmm. I'm never going to give up. No matter what, I'm going to keep on fighting.
All right. So, viewers, thank you for joining us today for our show, Color of Justice. And I'm your host, Milton Alimadi.